Welcome and greetings from high atop Caesar Rodney Square in beautiful downtown Wilmington, Delaware. I'm Rob Walter.
And I'm Matt Gotthold. And we are
the Podcast Pediatricians.
Find us on Stitcher, Google Play, and iTunes. And check out podcastpediatricians.com and leave us a message. Today we're going to start at the beginning. At the top, we are going to talk about babies' heads.
Baby head.
When I think of the term baby head, I always think of that character in the Toy Story movie. Right, Rob?
So, baby face.
Baby face. I don't know.
Spider baby.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. The leader of the mutant toys in Sid's room. The really incredibly creepy one.
Yeah, yeah. The guy with the baby head with the missing eye and the body made out of an erector set and like a spider body. Kind of creepy, but cool. Ended up helping Woody and Buzz. What year did Toy Story come out, Rob?
Okay, the only reason I know that is because it was the same weekend I saw that Michigan beat Ohio State to propel my Northwestern Wildcats into the Rose Bowl 1995 that I went to with my dad, and I'm flying to Chicago this weekend in the freezing cold to see the worst offense in the history of college football, Northwestern, lose to Purdue. But
nice.
I digress.
Okay. And who, wait a minute, let me hit you with some more trivia. Who was the original choice for Buzz? It was not Tim Allen. I'll give you a hint.
Okay.
He was the second choice.
Right. I only know that because, did you know the CNN series this summer, the movies? Oh, so good.
You know,
I don't
watch TV.
Well, I know. So they had an interview.
Except for Shirley Min on WHYY.
Well, of course. We all listen to her. And Bud and Dan, really, her backup.
Mm-hmm, yes.
So originally, I remember from that Billy Crystal was asked to voice Buzz Lightyear, and he turned it down, and he said it was the worst decision he made in his career, although Tim Allen said it was the best decision he made in his career. But I would think that the worst decision in his career, Billy Crystal, was Parental Guidance. Did you ever hear that movie?
No.
It was the worst.
It's probably a reason.
What's your favorite Billy movie?
When he was a cowboy guy. What was that called?
Oh, yeah.
You
I don't
remember
know.
They went to a dude ranch?
How about Harry Met Sally?
Mm-hmm. I liked it.
That was great.
That was okay.
But my personal favorite was Throw Mama from the Train.
Don't know that.
Oh,
one.
It's terrible. Yeah. It's so bad. It was good.
So here we go. Did Billy Crystal ever do any Pixar characters?
Mike Wazowski.
Oh, the one-eyed guy?
The monsters, yep.
Mm-hmm.
Did you see Toy Story 4?
I have not. Big question.
All right, here's your quiz. Mm-hmm. I have a visual quiz that people can't see. Who is this?
Mr. Bill with a brain hemorrhage.
Shirley Min, who is that?
Forky,
of course it's Forky. I am appalled that you didn't know that. And Bo Peep stole the movie. And
yeah.
Duke Kaboom, you'd like Duke Kaboom. Gabby, named after Chatty Cathy. You remember Chatty Cathy dolls?
I do remember Chatty Cathy.
They had those
dolls
in South Jersey? In the Pine Barrens?
My sister started chatting and I had to do her in.
You know, they shouldn't have made the movie, mm-hmm. but they made like over $1 billion.
Wow.
So that's why I did it. And before we jump in, any music?
Recently?
Yes.
Well, I have plans to go see Chris Knight in Washington at the winery. Jason and I, our friend.
I'm not invited, obviously.
Sorry, man. Two seats. at the winery in November. And so I got that, and then I realized that he was going to be in Philly 2 days prior to that. But I was going to ask you guys if you wanted to go again, but it's the same night as our book club.
Oh.
Yeah. What are we reading this time?
I got it here. It's called When the English Fall.
Yeah. Have you started it?
I have. Have you? You wait till like the last
not.
Day.
I do. That way I can remember it.
Okay. And then I saw on Broadway, because I know you never go to Broadway, but Slave Play,
mm-hmm.
very intense, controversial. Hadestown won the Tony last year.
Mm-hmm.
And I just saw Ain't Too Proud, which is kind of a jukebox musical on The Temptations.
Oh,
it was
okay.
Great. You would like it.
I would have liked
you
that.
You would like it.
Yeah,
you
that one
go.
I would have liked.
We're going to start, as always, with things in the pediatric news. And I have quite a big pile. But first, as always, Matt, our disclaimer.
We're sharing our own personal opinions on pediatric care. Always talk to your own pediatric caregiver about your child. Pediatric caregivers should always consult expert guidelines and consider their own community standards of care.
All right, here's your snack. We always start with a snack. Guess where this is from?
Wawa. Starbucks.
Capriati's.
Nice.
I had Bobby's for lunch, but I know you only like bacon sandwiches.
Right. I didn't know Capriati's made.
They do. They said they made them in
all
the
right.
store.
Yummy.
They're good.
Pithy. I like it. You know, kind of got
thumbs
a little,
up.
Got
all right.
a little bit of a substance to it. I like it. I like a heavy brownie. That is a brownie, right?
A substance to
yes,
it. That's
a substance
really
to
high praise
well,
for a brownie.
You want to go over the edge and take away their turkey business.
We got love to give you our views. Matt and Rob, look at the news. All right, we start with the flu. The flu is back. I've had a couple cases in my office. How about you?
I had two I suspected, but our testing in the office showed that they were negative. Although that, as you know, is only so accurate.
Right. And remember out there, check out our podcast number 24, Influenza and the Eagles.
Mm-hmm.
And I went back to look at that, and we taped that like a week after we won the Super Bowl.
Oh, excellent.
It was good times.
Good. That was good times.
Get your flu shot. You got your flu shot?
Of course I did.
Especially mm-hmm. you pregnant moms out there.
Mm-hmm.
You should definitely get your flu shot. Don't wait till the baby's delivered.
Yep. Even people who are afraid of flu shots should really be convinced to get them.
I hear even like TV hosts finally have gotten
TV
a flu shot.
TV hosts, you know, various sundry people in the community. Everybody is, because the herd immunity really counts.
Absolutely. And last year, 116 kids in the United States died of the flu.
That's...
And half of them were totally healthy and most didn't get the flu shot. 62,000 Americans died of the flu last year, mostly older people. And again, the reason you give kids flu shots to help them, but also so grandpa and grandma and great-grandma doesn't die.
Yeah, there's definitely a secondary advantage to the flu shot that really helps to protect the community. So hopefully you've gotten our point across there.
Yes, and a couple of new things on the flu shot. You can use the 0.5 milligram now at any age.
Mm-hmm.
That's new. And are you doing that, or are you still using the lower dose for the little ones?
We're using the 0.5 across the board.
So we're using mm-hmm. the 0.25 for the lower ones, but vaccine for children, VFC for state and uninsured, they only have the 0.5s, and they work just as well. And are you doing the nasal flu?
The only nasal flu we have in the office is thanks to the vaccines for children, you know, through the Medicaid program.
We bought a few. I mean, mm-hmm. we've been burned on it before,
yeah.
and this year they say it's just as good. And I know mm-hmm. a lot of kids like, I'd rather get the nasal one. So we have a few in case kids just won't get the regular flu. But
it bothers me
I'm
a little
skeptical.
Bit. Yeah, I mean, it bothers me a little bit that the official opinion seems to vacillate from year to year as to its efficacy. And so given that, I think we really are best off minimizing that option. Yeah, especially because most of the studies are retrospective. So if you don't know,
right,
and we know that it's either as good as or not quite as good as the injection
right.
really.
They're
going
to have
no
to
sense.
Really win us over a few years in a row.
I think so.
And remember, fever, sore throat, cough, congestion. When the flu hits, really knocks you down. That's that sudden fever, chills, myalgias, the muscle. The little kids get vomiting, nausea, diarrhea sometimes too.
Yeah, the muscly thing is oftentimes the thing that, you know, kind of alerts us to this, you know, awful headache, muscle, GI stuff. I mean,
right.
it's just every seemingly everything that could hurt does.
So my big question for you, we haven't talked about this, is what do you say to a mom who says, hey, just had a newborn baby, and I had this happen in my office pretty often.
Mm-hmm.
My mother-in-law, let's say, won't get the flu shot.
Mm-hmm.
Do I let her see my baby? I'm nervous about her being near my baby.
Yeah, we get that. And we also get, you know, folks have friends who don't vaccinate or only partially
right.
vaccinate. And so that's always a really hot button topic.
Right.
I will bounce the question oftentimes back to the family and say, you know, you've got to do what's right on so many different levels. But I can tell you that you are, at least in theory, putting your baby in peril by having them around folks who aren't vaccinated in the midst of flu season.
Right. It's also a little difference between the non-vaxxers and the flu.
Mm-hmm.
It's tough, though, to tell someone, yeah, don't let your mother-in-law see their first grandchild. So
absolutely.
I kind of talked about that. I said, listen, if they're not sick, they're washing their hands,
mm-hmm.
and it's their grandchild, I think you should, you know, I don't think it'd be a huge risk to your baby. If you want to kind of shame a little bit, have them wear a mask.
The risk is limited. I mean, as you know, and we've talked about this umpteen times here on the podcast, what we'll usually do is use the filter of what would I do in my own family? What would I do with my own child? What would I do with my own mother-in-law? And oftentimes that kind of calls us out a little bit as we're having in the midst of that conversation, because everyone's a little bit different. You know,
right.
we like to have rules and regs, but to be honest with you, every situation is just a smidge different, and you really have to adapt your answer to that, I think.
Right. We said before, I don't like to diss grandma. They can be scary. Grandpas
That's
don't
when you
say
put
much.
Grandma in a headlock and call for your nurse.
Grandpas don't say much, but the
nurse
grandmas.
In the needle.
Uh-huh. And then we talked before about, you know, we do rapid tests, and we use kind of the CHOP decision tree that, you know, if they're over 2 and not that sick and no risk factors is not a great reason to test and then start giving, you know, antivirals, which have side effects. A big thing in antivirals, though, first time this year, there's a new medicine
mm-hmm.
for 12 and above that instead of twice a day for 5 days, it's just one pill
mm-hmm.
once.
Yes.
And it's called Balaxoair or Xofluza, which again, every new medicine has to have an X in it. That's
of
kind
course.
Of a rule with big pharma.
That's a sexy new thing.
So it's 3 times more expensive. Are you going to maybe use it?
No.
No? Definitely not?
Doubtful. it's one of those situations where if the information's limited, we already got burned once on the whole Tamiflu extravaganza from the standpoint of it. And we've talked about this ad nauseum in past podcasts. Its efficacy is extraordinarily limited. It seems to be something that has been marketed to be some type of a panacea, and it's actually not. And we have folks coming in and asking for it. That's actually where I think the CHOP decision tree comes into handy for us. You know, Children's Hospital of Philadelphia, arguably one of the best children's hospitals in the world, does not hand out Tamiflu.
It does. Right. But what's going to happen, you know, is that they're going to just have a huge amount of advertisements for this. Parents are going to say, hey, it's a single pill. And, you know, I'm in high school. I've got my test coming up. I'm in college. Can you give me the pill?
Are you comfortable that there's enough data?
On this one, no. I look at the data. The data actually looks better than Tamiflu. So it's not.
It's hard to look worse.
You can make the argument, should we give anything?
Right.
But if you're going to give something, I'm comfortable with this.
And what's the promise of this med?
The promise is that it's a single dose. It looks in studies, it looks better than the Tamiflu. And you're much more likely to take it once as opposed to something twice a day for 5 days. So again, it gets to, should we give it at all? Second topic, just quickly, because we've talked about vaping well before it was fashionable, about how terrible it is. And
yes,
with all these deaths and all these injuries and over 1,800 illnesses in 49 states, 38 deaths. The Daily Podcast did a great two-parter on vaping and on juuling, about those two Stanford, now billionaires,
yes,
who came up with this awful product, and that the old Philip Morris bought juuling, and so now they're really being run by a
tobacco company.
They still refuse to pull mint and the menthol flavors.
Right.
Especially the mint. That's what the young people are using. Middle schoolers, high schoolers. Are you seeing much problems in the office? Because I have a couple of juuling addicts. It'd be better if they were smoking cigarettes, a lot less nicotine.
Unfortunately, that's true. You know, one has to kind of stop short of necessarily making that recommendation. But no, I had a couple of really frantic calls from teenage boys when the news broke that people were dying from this, and they wanted me to see them immediately to make sure that they were okay. So really, I mean, the message got through, I think, at least to some folks.
Right. Yeah. Don't want all these kids to be sick, but the silver lining to all that is that it's getting people to say, oh, these really suck.
Right.
And we got to keep them away. So Journal Pediatrics, Journal Club, Singulaire, Montelukast. We did an episode on asthma. We both said we weren't like, it's not our favorite medication,
right,
but they just put a warning out about neuropsychiatric risk factors in terms of anxiety and sleep disturbances that you see in the first 90 days.
And so, we discussed that.
And we've seen that.
I mean, this is not new news.
Right. We've seen that. So it's another piece that, but I think we have to be careful.
And I think that has to come with the appropriate, you know, warnings to the family in terms of if your child starts to act unusually, there is a limited, you know, possibility that something like that could happen. Please stop the medicine right away and let us know. But it does certainly have its, like so many other medicines, there's the upside and there's the downside.
But the mainstay, as we say, of asthma treatment is inhaled steroids. Inhaled steroids. Here's a Delaware thing. I don't know if you've ever been there, but the Green Room is closing.
Yes,
at the Hotel DuPont.
Mm-hmm.
Have you been there?
Yeah. In fact, I think we took my son actually turns 21 today. I believe we took my oldest daughter there for her 21st birthday.
I thought he was like 7.
Yeah. I thought he was 7 too until he wasn't. Time flies, right?
Wow. Yeah. So, you know, it's been over 100
Shout
years.
Out. Happy birthday, Justin.
Happy birthday, Justin. Over 100 years, the Green Room. And I can understand they want to redo it and spruce it up. But why lose that Green Room?
Yeah.
Generations went there.
Sure.
Grace Kelly went there. They had the Joe Biden table I got to sit in once. So it's
all right. Just off the top of my head, Grace Kelly or Audrey Hepburn? Who would you rather have dinner with?
Audrey Hepburn.
Me too.
Okay. More relatable?
Yeah, just quirky.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So very quickly, there's a big article about prednisolone versus dexamethasone for croup. Mm-hmm. We talked about that in an episode, that most of the out people in the community use like prednisolone for a few days instead of one dose dexamethasone.
Yes.
So they did this huge study, but they gave one dose of each. That's
right.
Not how we use it.
That
we do it for 3 days. So they said there was no difference, but I say flawed study.
Flawed study.
Forget about it.
Yep.
Suicide. We did episode 35 on suicide, and it has continued to explode, up 56% in the last 10 years on youth suicide, the highest rate in about 20 years. And a shameless plug for R.Y. Warren, which Matt and I are both moderating in a week.
Yes,
see
we
if
are.
You get this out before. The main keynote speaker, Dr. David Brent. is talking about pediatric suicide.
So just for our listeners, ROY Warren is a lecture series that's given every year that Rob actually helps to put together.
And I got Matt to do it with me.
He did. And I came cheaply, yes. I think it was like a bag of fries or something. But right. It really features a broad offering of pediatric education for folks. And it comes at a very cheap price for great education and CMEs.
It's a 50th anniversary, so $50 for lunch, breakfast, and lots of CME. They were doing it on suicide, bullying, autism, the flu, vaccine refusals, vaping, a lot of stuff we talk about.
Yes.
And the microbiome, which I know you love.
Ah, I love the microbiome.
Another paper from Pediatric, which I think might be really exciting, is treating strep for 5 days instead of 10 days.
Yes.
And it works just as well.
And we've been through this. I mean, we did, I think, 2 whole episodes on strep a while ago,
right,
which really came down to the bottom line of the idea of treating strep throat for 10 days with penicillins is really based on studies from the 1950s.
And World War II, when the strains had a lot more rheumatic fever and a lot more kidney problems, which they don't. So it's not like this is not an official recommendation. You can't go out there and just give 5 days.
Right.
But I think we're getting there, which
that'd
will be really nice.
I mean, the less antibiotics that we use, but use effectively, the better.
We have not mentioned, and I don't want to do a disservice, but we have not mentioned acute flaccid myelitis, which is this scary polio-like illness that's really hit the country in the last few years. There's been, last year, 233 cases in 41 states. The average age 5. It's like an enterovirus like polio, and they get a viral illness first, and then they get this paralysis that a lot of bulletins went out in the last couple of months saying that pediatricians, family medicine, nurse practitioners, PAs need to just recognize this early.
Crazy,
as soon as you
scary.
See it, to call the CDC, and they can get CSF samples. Usually you can find it on MRI. You see gray matter changes.
Mm-hmm.
And most of these kids don't get completely better. So
it's scary. Really tragic. It's scary. And really, to my knowledge, at least, unless you you have any more updated information, there's really no therapy
for it
except for supportive therapy.
It's
which
supportive.
Is
it's
where
supportive.
We find ourselves, unfortunately, with a lot of things that are horrible diseases.
Right. Zantac. We both know about this. They came out a few months ago saying that Zantac can be broken down into NDMA of N-nitrodimethylamine, which is kind of...
That was awesome.
I know, which is what you see in grilled meats, but it's a carcinogen.
Mm-hmm.
And they said maybe we shouldn't use Zantac.
Zantac
which is
doesn't
a mainstay.
Taste nearly as good as grilled meats,
it's,
though.
It's true. What do you like? Porchetta? What's your...
Porchetta, man.
Porchetta. Yes. So... Have you had this patient say, because we give a lot of babies Zantac.
Yes.
Are people saying, what should we do?
Absolutely. We've had a lot of patients call and ask to have their H2 blockers changed to something different. We have had, actually, I had a lot of medical professionals whose children I take care of notify our office within the first couple of days of that announcement that they would really prefer to be on something different. Now, the interesting aspect of this, as I understand it, and from speaking to pharmacists, is it really is the tablets. There wasn't a relationship with the solution or the liquid. I don't know if you've heard differently.
Well, the official report that came out from the FDA just this week says using prescription ranitidine and nizatidine, which is the Axid, which really is the same thing. So it's not any different. They're not making that distinction and no one is saying it. So I think that it could be in a liquid that we're giving to, you know, 1, 2, 3 month olds sometimes. We try not to. On the other hand, the alternatives, Pepcid, is not as good.
Mm-hmm.
So
it's a dilemma. Yeah.
It's a dilemma. Next in the news, just want to mention a really heartfelt letter from a Dr. Hoot that was published in Pediatrics last month called Nicinersen for Type 1 Spinal Muscular Atrophy, A Father's Perspective. And, you know, as you remember, that's Wernicke-Hoffmann disease, a very, especially type 1, very difficult.
Heartbreaking
condition where they really are almost paralyzed and they usually die of respiratory complications very early. And I took care of a few patients in medical school with that who were on ventilators and also spent a month at the Dubowitz Center in London. It was a muscle center, and that was one of their big things is spinal muscular atrophy. And there was no cure for it. Well, there is a treatment now, and it's amazing. And the letter is about how his child would probably not be living and how it's amazing how it turned things around. It cost $750,000 a year, and then about $375,000 a year after. And it's just talking about how, from a father's point of view, and he's a PICU doctor or an ER doctor, I think. From that point of view, you could talk about healthcare and about how much resources could go to this one condition, which is like almost $1 million versus how much you can do to save many lives around the world.
Right.
But it's his son.
Right.
And how amazing it was. And, you know, that hopefully the prices will go down. And we always get on Big Pharma's case. I mean, we really do a lot. But again, the other flip side of it is that amazing things come out of it.
Yes.
And this is one of them. So I highly recommend that you read that article.
I will definitely read that.
And there's a quick one about mumps. There's been a few things coming out. And we know that they had a temple outbreak last year that the mumps vaccine does wane. And for a lot of people, it stops working.
Yes.
And so the issue isn't that they're non-vaxxers. The issue that it's not working as well. And the question is, should we give a mumps booster? And I don't know about you. I used to give a tetanus booster at, you know, going to college around 18, 19. You give the tetanus booster following up the original tetanus you got around 11.
Mm-hmm.
But now I've changed over to Adacel again, which also has pertussis in it.
Mm-hmm.
Because I feel like they're going to college, they should get covered again for pertussis. So far, I haven't had an insurance company kick it out, but I'm not sure it's an official recommendation yet. What are you doing for these 18,
19-year-olds? No, I usually don't, although it's certainly something to consider. Yeah, especially with pertussis being a bigger and bigger issue as time goes on. You know, there's so many seeds of pertussis. There are people for whom the vaccine has waned, and then there are the people who just aren't getting the vaccine.
Right.
Pose a risk to our patients as well.
And lastly, just kind of a game changer that just jumped off the page to me also in pediatrics from last month. It's called the feasibility of fast MRI to reduce CT radiation exposure with acute traumatic head injuries. Basically, they're getting better and better at doing fast MRI for pediatric head injuries, so we don't need to do a CT scan.
Great.
And so there's way less radiation, but you don't need the sedation.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a game changer.
Oh, for sure. I think a lot of that's a matter of access as well. As you well know, it's hard to get an MRI with any degree of expediency unless you're a neurologist or a neurosurgeon.
Right. But the big thing for MRI was that MRI wasn't good at looking at blood.
Right.
And subarachnoid hemorrhage. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't, even if you had it, it didn't work well for head trauma. So it was always CT scan or nothing.
Right.
But now I guess they've gotten better.
Yeah.
So that will be huge.
Oh, it's huge. And you know, combine that with the fact that now with the various treatment algorithms that a lot of the ER docs have, imaging the head has really is not as common anymore now as it was. And so if it can be done selectively, then even better.
Absolutely. Okay, Maddie, before we break and get into baby heads, a few plugs for our sponsors. And we have a new sponsor. It's called High Five Services. That's the letter H, capital, then a small I, then the number 5, then the letter S. And the website is highfives.com. It's an information technology IT company based right here in Delaware, serving Delaware, Pennsylvania, New Jersey, and Maryland. And as you know, Matthew, because you bring it up to me a lot, my practice was hacked when we had just moved to EMR, and we didn't have a lot of visits on it, and nothing was taken, and we didn't have credit cards on it, but still, it got into potentially there could have been issues with our old server that had thousands of names from the past. It was a huge hassle, and lawyers got involved. And it's scary for a small business like ours,
sure
worrying
is.
About huge fines and lawyer fees, losing trust of our families. And we were lucky enough to have cyber insurance and had to send out thousands of letters just with an abundance of caution. But it was not fun. It's another reason why I hate EMR besides the increased burnout and, to me, worse than patient care and hours we have to spend at night doing charts, but I digress on that. We felt at that time we needed the best firewall protection possible 24/7, especially busy practices like ours who are open on the weekends. And who are you going to call when you need help, Matt? Who are you going to call? Don't say Ghostbusters. What you're going to call, you're going to call a Marine. So we called a Marine. Jim Hansen founded High Fives and Hansen Information Systems about 20 years ago when returning from post-military stint in Germany, and he provided programming there for Army headquarters. He just stepped right in, diagnosed the issues, upgraded us to state-of-the-art firewall security system and to repel any hackers trying to encrypt data. And you could be hackers. It could be a solar storm. That's the crux of the book. That's in book club. this month that Matt has not read called When the English Fall.
But it will.
So there could be a solar storm that ruins your computers. Jim's team also does systems administration, website development, PHP programming, and MySQL database development, which I have no idea what that means. But that's the point. We don't want to know what that means. We just want to make sure it's done.
We don't speak this language.
And it's safe. The biggest silver lining of our whole hack is that we got into Jim Hansen and his group. He diagnosed things, he finds the most cost-effective solutions, and he purchases from local-based companies whenever possible, which both Matt and I really love
really
when they use people in our tri-state area. So it's a breath of fresh air when we can call Jim, and he also works really well with our EMR company rep. So remember, highfives.com, Jim Hansen, his phone number, 871-483-1040 for all your IT needs. And we have two other sponsors.
Yes, indeed we do. So stepping into a sponsor that's near and dear to both Rob's and my heart and minds is Triage for Pediatrics. So Rob, you can vouch for this. I will absolutely vouch for this. This has been a complete game changer for us as pediatricians. We have nurses cover for us from my practice. It's between 11 o'clock at night and 7 in the morning, but you can choose your hours. Usually, for those of you out there who are practicing pediatric providers, if you're on call, absolutely one of the worst things that we experience is being woken up at night. And so please make it a point to educate yourself on Triage for Pediatrics and CEO Julie Ortiz. Wow, this has been just an amazing experience for our practice and for Rob's as well. I know I can speak for him in this context.
Absolutely.
And lastly, our standby sponsor from the standpoint of keeping us all nice and warm at night is Campus Quilts. And we just can't say enough good things about the quality work that they do. They are artists. They'll take t-shirts. They'll take any type of a wearable and make it into a quilt for you. I know that Rob has had these made for his kids. I know that one of my children has one of these, and they are just, they'll be in the family forever.
They're great. And also, Christmas is coming up and Hanukkah. So you want to order now to get it ready for then. And you know when Hanukkah starts this year, Matt?
Would that be Hanukkah with an H or a CH?
Either way.
I do not.
It's actually late, so it starts December 22nd.
Wow.
So this year, Hanukkah and Christmas will actually overlap.
Hmm.
A couple years ago, there was Thanksgivica, when Thanksgiving and Hanukkah overlapped. So I want to just keep you in the loop. We get 8 presents
uh-huh.
in a row. Christmas just gets one day, so I'm sorry.
Yes.
Sorry for all your old Christmas people. Campusquilts.com.
Campusquilts.com. Fantastic, fantastic work that they do. And believe us, your family will really appreciate this for years to come.
And for all of these, mention Podcast Pediatricians when you order and you'll get a discount, a nice discount. We'll be right back.
You got a friend in me. You got a friend in me. When the road looks rough ahead and you're miles and miles from your nice warm bed.
And we are back.
So, back to babies' noggins. This is, in general, the very first part of the baby that anyone actually sees. Most babies are delivered head first. And in most cases, this is the safest way to deliver a baby. Much safer than bottom first, which is called Frank breech, if the infant's feet are sticking straight up in front of the body with the feet near the head, or a complete breech if the buttocks are down and the legs are folded at the knees with the feet near the butt. The third type of breech presentation is an incomplete breech, which can have any combination of one or both hips extended, also known as footling, one leg extended breech, or double footling with, you guessed it, Rob,
two,
both legs extended.
Have you even thought about those things since you were in medical school?
No, because I've not been in the delivery room except for my own children for quite some time. And golly, as I said, my baby's 21, so it's really been quite a while.
Do you miss it? Did you like going to the delivery room?
You know what? There was a level of excitement to it, but it was mostly in the middle of the night when you were dead tired, and
right.
That wasn't very exciting at all.
Right. So when we did our residency, we were in the delivery room at high risk waiting for the baby.
Yes.
And I've always thought, like, I'd rather be here waiting for the baby
mm-hmm.
than being there pulling the baby out.
True.
So we've saluted the OBs many times. It's
all
amazing
day long. They're
what
fantastic
they do.
People. Yep. So how common are breech deliveries, you ask? Robin?
You don't know.
4 in every 100 deliveries are breech.
And what is the most common breech position?
Frank
breech, not Frank Costanza, not Frank Burns, the Frank breach. Most healthcare providers that deliver babies recommend a C-section to deliver all babies in the breech position. This type of delivery is particularly recommended if the infant is premature, since these babies are more fragile and their head is large relative to their body, so the infant is not likely to be able to provide the appropriate stretch to the cervix the way a full-term baby can. This means there may be less room for the baby head to emerge. So some quick stats here, El Matador. Now, we do script some things. I would never call you El Matador. Is that a nickname? Is that a nickname that you picked for yourself? Like, you want me to call you El Matador?
It's what I want you to call me.
Is that like Buck Naked, El Matador?
No. Although we have shared that at one point in my life, I wanted to be called, what was it, Scooter? Skippy? Something like that. Yeah. Got over that really
quickly.
Well,
it's not going to be El Matador.
Okay, cool.
So at 28 weeks gestation or less, about 25%, one in four babies are breech. But by 32 weeks, you know, 4 weeks later, only about 7% of babies are breech. And prior to the 1950s in the United States, vaginal delivery was the preferred way to deliver an infant who was in the breech position. In the U.S., in 1970, not that long ago, C-section rates for breech presentations were only 12%. And by 2002, 32 years later, the rate of C-sections for breech had risen to 86%. Now, overall, C-sections in the United States are about 32%, which is up from 24% 15 years ago. Even though the World Health Organization recommends that we should only be doing about a 15% C-section rate, and internationally, the C-section rate is only 21% compared to our 32%. So here's your quiz, Matt. Do you remember many episodes ago, we talked about the country that had the highest number of C-sections?
Palau. I remember we talked about Palau at one point.
I love Palau. But no, it's actually Brazil at 55%. And in some areas of Rio, it's almost 85%. Like nobody gets vaginal delivery. It's crazy. And which state, Matt, has the highest rate of C-sections in the United States?
I'm going to go Mississippi.
I don't know why you picked that note, but in the same vein...
I picked
vein,
Mississippi because it has, to my knowledge, the highest rate of obesity.
Okay, but if I think about which state is probably going to be the worst at something, my fallback is New Jersey, right? So the answer is the highest rate in the U.S. of C-sections is New Jersey.
Hey, that's like New Jersey-ist. Phobic or something like that. I don't know.
Good comeback. Good New Jersey comeback.
Hey, you mess with a bull, you get the horns. All right. Currently, the American College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists Committee on Obstetric Practice suggests the use of external cephalic version. And failing success with that, they recommend a planned C-section delivery for a persistent singleton breech presentation at term. Singletons? What's your favorite singleton, Rob?
Easy, easy. Are both our favorite singletons.
Yes.
Our old friend from residency, Dr. Krista Singleton. Remember Krista?
I do.
I looked her up. I Googled her. She's a pediatrician in Atlanta, and she's the senior public health advisor to the CDC. So our people that we know that were juniors go on to these great things.
We're connected.
I'm sitting here
across from you in a Northwestern football jersey, for God's sakes.
So how about you, Matt? What's your favorite singleton?
Well, you know, outside of Krista, my favorite is... Kenny Singleton. Yes, played for a variety of Major League baseball teams. Mets, Expos, Orioles. He won the Roberto Clemente Award in 1982. And as you well know, Roberto Clemente Award is given to the player combining good play and strong work in the community, just like Alberto Clemente.
He was great. How many hits did he have?
He had quite a lot.
Well,
3,000 plus,
exactly 3,000.
Yes. Really, I mean, exactly.
He died too young, but like in his last game, he got his 3,000s, and then he died giving aid.
I did not know that.
Was it aid to Puerto Rico?
It was aid to someplace in Central America.
Yes,
I don't think it was Puerto Rico.
But being very selfless.
Yes. Fantastic. But well, I'll tell you who isn't my favorite singleton.
Who's not your favorite singleton?
No. Antron Singleton. I looked this up. Also known as Big Lurch. Who is noted in Wikipedia as being an American rapper and cannibal.
Wait, so Lurch like from the Addams Family?
Yes.
Or not Lurch from the Addams Family?
Yes,
and
absolutely.
I like the way you said rapper and cannibal. like they go together, like rapper and actor, Will Smith, rapper and cannibal. Is that
rapper,
like,
and producer?
A usual thing?
Yes. I probably should have led with the cannibal part, I would think. Cannibal and American rapper sounds much more sensational, don't you think?
So
back to Big Lurch. Apparently,
do we have to go back to Big Lurch?
Yes, now you have to hear the whole story. Come on. Apparently, he killed while on PCP, and cannibalism was reportedly involved after that fact. I got a joke for you. Ready?
Ready.
Because it was just
ready.
Halloween. We went through all the Halloween jokes. Here, let me hit you with a quick Halloween joke. Why didn't the skeleton go to the dance?
Okay. Why didn't the skeleton go to the dance?
Because he had no body to go with. All right. Now, I'll move right on to the cannibal joke. Hey, Rob.
Hey,
why don't cannibals eat
Matador.
Clowns?
Okay. Why don't cannibals eat clowns?
Because they taste funny.
we crack ourselves up.
You could come to my office and hear this all day long.
Yeah, you wait for me. I'll be right there.
Yeah.
All right. So my other favorite Singleton is John Singleton, film director, screenwriter, and producer. Unfortunately, he recently died following a stroke in April at the age of 51. He was best known for directing Boys in the Hood, for which he was nominated for the Academy Award for Best Director, becoming at age 24 the first African-American and youngest person ever to be nominated for that award in 1991. Tell me who's on the list of all African-Americans to win the Best Director Oscar.
Best Director, huh?
Nobody.
Oh.
Not even Spike Lee.
Wow.
But director Spike Lee did win Best Adapted Screenplay for Black Klansman when he was the director of the movie. And also Jordan Peele won Best Original Screenplay for Get Out when he directed Get Out. Did you
good
see
flick.
Get Out? We know
I
we talked
did,
about that.
Boy, good,
oh,
good movie.
Isn't it?
Yeah, maybe Leaping. My favorite in recent years. Just so well acted. Such a, oh. Really
and
good.
We don't like horror movies, but
no,
it
no,
was
not
good.
At all.
All right,
okay.
Back to deliveries.
All right. The American College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists Committee on Obstetric Practice Recommendation was amended to allow vaginal delivery of a term singleton breech if there is a detailed patient-informed consent and by a healthcare provider experienced in vaginal breech delivery. That's a lot of the times where the rub is. There's a fair amount of debate amongst experts on whether or not cesarean section is necessary in a situation where the baby is breech or whether it truly improves outcome. There are multiple studies that have demonstrated lower rates of morbidity and mortality to the infant with an elective C-section, but these studies demonstrate increased risk for maternal morbidity. Some experts believe that the risk involved with delivering a breech baby vaginally is primarily due to the fact that most obstetricians are not experienced in breech
right.
birth management.
Not anymore.
Nope. Due to the high use of cesarean delivery, especially in Brazil, for breech babies and not actually due to innate risk in the process of breech vaginal deliveries. They believe, with an obstetrical team that's skilled, that breech birth is a safe option in the absence of other complicating factors.
But the number of providers who deliver infants who actually have skills to deliver a breech baby vaginally has vastly diminished over the years from back in 1970 when most did it. And so even in teaching hospitals where experienced faculty arguably are available, there may not be sufficient numbers of vaginal breech deliveries to adequately teach this procedure. And I've talked to a couple of OBs, moms in my practice, and none of them will do a vaginal delivery of a breech unless it's the second baby of twins. Then they will do that. But otherwise,
wow.
they will not.
Mm-hmm.
And they're really good. It reminds me of VBACs,
mm-hmm.
which are vaginal deliveries after previous C-sections. So that in parts of the country can be tough. If you've had a C-section first,
mm-hmm.
in many parts of the country, you have to do C-section again. You cannot
right.
do a vaginal. But a lot of places, including our home Christiana Hospital, OBs,
mm-hmm.
will do it if the situation is right, which is great because some of these moms
yeah.
really want to have a vaginal delivery after they had a first C-section.
Much less trauma to the mom if that goes well.
To avoid the need for unnecessary C-sections for breech babies, many OBs and midwives recommend that attempts made to turn the baby, as you mentioned, the external cephalic version, before the onset of labor. Essentially, it involves manipulating the baby's newborn's body through the mom's abdomen, moving them inside the womb to put the baby's head downward in the head-first position to be delivered through the cervix eventually. And I've seen this done. It is freaky to watch. And amazing they could turn the baby in the womb. most OBs I talk to say right away when they examine the mom, they know if it's going to work or not. They know if, you know, the, yeah. if the head's really engaged, there's no way they're going to turn that baby. Mm-hmm. And since this is the baby head episode, we should mention that breech babies often have a very specific head shape, long and thin, called dolichocephaly, with a prominent occipital shelf, kind of like Daryl Strawberry. Do you remember?
Yeah.
Being a Met fan at the time. The main thing he had was a long, thin head.
He did
but
indeed.
Remember, all breech babies should have a hip ultrasound done at 6 to 8 weeks of age, especially Frank breech, to check for hip dysplasia, since this is most common in breech babies.
So, the infant's head is what we're going to focus on today. It seems simple enough, but there's a lot going on here. Well, maybe not so much in Rob's case. Let's start with the consequences of the birthing process itself. For those who are unfamiliar with the process, it's not always easy. And although moms certainly bear the brunt of the experience here, the infant is subjected to a variety of different forces as well, not the least of which is pressure on the head and scalp. But first, some anatomy. An infant's skull is made up of 6 separate cranial or skull bones.
Which I mention in the office all the time. Mm-hmm. We're talking about heads. I say, all right, your baby's head has 6 separate bones.
Yes.
Nice to tell people that.
Mm-hmm. It's good you get the number right, too.
Yes.
There's a frontal bone, an occipital bone, 2 parietal bones, and 2 temporal bones. Do the math. 6. All right, great. These bones are held together by strong, leathery, elastic tissues called sutures. Confusing terminology, as usual, in medicine, since sutures are also the strings used to close wounds or used to meld tissues together. Knowledge of this terminology is how we keep out the riffraff. But between bones and sutures are spaces that remain open in babies and very young children, which are called fontanelles, also known as soft spots. Robbo, what does the word fontanelle mean?
Ooh, I know, that's easy. Fontanelle is Italian for fountain, like... We both in the last few years saw the Trevi Fontanelle in Rome. Yes? Am I right?
No. Oh. It means hollow between two muscles, from the old French fontanelle, a small source, fountain, or spring.
All right, there's a fountain in there.
Well, it's an analogy to the dent in the earth where a spring arises in reference to the hollow in a baby's skull, and it was first recorded as a term, as a thing, in 1741.
These spaces, or soft spots, are part of normal development. The cranial bones remain separate for about 12 to 18 months. Then they grow together as part of normal development, and they stay connected throughout adulthood. Now, 2 fontanelles, or soft spots, are usually present in a newborn skull. One is at the top of the middle of the head, just forward of the center, and that's called the anterior fontanelle. That's the main soft spot that we all know and love and parents reference. Another is in the back, in the middle of the head. That's called the posterior fontanelle.
So if somebody had eyes in the back of their head, this would be reversed.
I guess you think about that very much. I never thought of that before. Is that something like where you grew up, like people had
in the Pine Barrens?
In the Pine Barrens. Okay.
That extra digits usually it's sprung from various parts of their bodies, but not eyes in the back of their
okay.
head.
Okay. So the posterior fontanelle usually closes by 1 to 2 months of age, and in fact, many are closed at birth. The anterior fontanelle usually closes sometime between 9 months and 23 months. In a study using CT scans of infants and toddlers from 0 to 24 months of age, at 5 to 9 months, 3% of the fontanelles were closed. At 10 to 12, it went up to 21%. 13 to 15, 35%. 16 to 18 months old, 60% were closed. 19 to 21 months, 84%. And by 22 to 24 months, so by 2 years of age, 89% of the anterior fontanelles were closed. And these findings, you know, indicate there's a significant variability as to when the anterior fontanelle closes, and that early or delayed closure may be a normal variant. Early closure of the anterior fontanelle is not uncommon, but it should put all of us pediatricians on alert that maybe there's an issue, an increased risk for them having a small head or microcephaly. Other things that can cause early closure of the anterior fontanelle include things like hyperthyroidism, craniosynostosis, which we'll get to, and hypophosphatasia or hyperparathyroidism. We do get, Matt, right? We get a lot of fontanelle and soft spot questions. And
we
I got to say, my son, my oldest, his fontanelle closed early. in the, you know, in the first like 5 to 6 months, so in that first 3%, but his head was growing well, the shape was fine, he was pretty bright. So again, it bears emphasizing that the vast majority of babies with small or early closing soft spots are completely normal.
Indeed. On the other hand, delayed closure can indicate an issue. The most common causes of delayed closure of the anterior fontanelle include normal variation, congenital hypothyroidism, primary megalencephaly, increased intracranial pressure, and rickets, among others. Is there such a thing as a third fontanelle? The third fontanelle.
That still has a third fontanelle.
The third fontanelle is not actually a fontanelle. It's a bony defect, which is about 2 centimeters or an inch in front of the posterior fontanelle along the sagittal suture between the anterior and the posterior fontanelles. It's believed to be caused by an incomplete mineralization of the parietal bones. In studies of consecutive newborn infants, 2 to 6% have a palpable third fontanelle, but no infants older than 90 days had a palpable third fontanelle. The sutures and fontanelles are needed for the infant's brain growth and development. During childbirth, the elasticity of the sutures permits the skull bones to overlap so that the baby's head can pass through the birth canal without pressing on and damaging their brains. During infancy and childhood, the sutures continue to be flexible. This permits the brain to grow quickly and also serves as a mechanism to protect the brain from minor trauma to the head, which occur all the time when infants roll over or sit up and fall back down. And without the give that sutures and fontanelles provide, the child's brain would not be able to expand and brain damage can result.
Now, pediatricians are able to assess the pressure inside an infant's skull, which is the pressure on their brain, by feeling the tension of the fontanelles, especially that anterior fontanelle. The fontanelle usually should feel flat and have a little mild tension. If a fontanelle is under high pressure, it's known as bulging. And a bulging fontanelle can be a sign of increased intracranial pressure within the brain. This can be from infection like meningitis, where the baby is usually really, really sick, or hydrocephalus. In this situation, imaging studies such as a CT scan or MRI is used to see the brain structures and any consequences of increase in intracranial pressure. Also, because you have this window of the soft spot, head ultrasounds can be used through the soft spot to look at the brain. It's somewhat limited. You can't see much more than straight down. You can't see the sides, but much less radiation than CT scan and is much quicker and doesn't need sedation like an MRI. Now, surgery may be required in order to relieve the intracranial pressure increase for certain types of hydrocephalus. And what if the fontanelle has low pressure or it's sunken? This can sometimes be a sign of dehydration. And a lot of parents report it as a big worry, but really it's a really late sign of dehydration. And it's much more obvious signs, mucous membranes being really dry or decreased capillary refills of their fingers.
Lack of urine output.
Right. Now, some baby soft spots kind of sunken all the time, and it's okay. I saw a baby like this the other day. It just, the kid was smiling, happy. It just really felt like it was sunk, and it was fine. And the other thing, last thing about soft spots, and we see this a lot, is routinely, if you look at the right angle, you will see an infant soft spot pulsating, especially if they're bald. And it's completely normal. It reflects their pulse and heartbeat, but really off-putting. You know, when you see some of these babies, like, boop, 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 looks like something out of Halloween.
Especially for someone who's not used to seeing soft spots on a daily basis like we are, it's a little bit disturbing. Yeah, as a parent, like, is it supposed to do that?
I know. Yes. So I think we're going to call it here and get back to baby heads on the next episode. Because we have a lot more to talk about, including shapes and plagiocephaly and such, and helmets and such. We do want to thank Shirley Min and Bud and Dan from WHYY for sharing.
We were
our
kind.
Episode.
They were kind enough to come in and witness the debacle here today.
And we were like, us? You want to watch us?
Escaped virtually unscathed, except for Rob made them eat a bobby.
I bought them bobbies, and it's delicious.
Remember, folks, a bobby is stuffing on bread.
Who doesn't like stuffing and cranberry sauce and turkey?
There is some cranberry sauce and turkey.
They were all kind of surprised, Matt, that you were not a Bobby fan.
I apparently was odd man out on that one.
It's just the taste of Delaware.
Mm-hmm. Those that sandwich chain makes fantastic sandwiches. I just, you know, bread on bread.
We love Capriati. Mm-hmm. So not a sponsor, but we love Capriati's.
Yes, we do.
All right, Matt. Say goodnight.
Indeed. Good night.
podcast, Pediatricians Productions. All rights reserved.